Experiment 5 in Chem 1310 is titled Quantum Mechanics, Window to Atomic Structure. In this experiment, we're going to investigate the quantum properties of atoms. In the first part of the experiment, we'll look in general terms at the behavior of waves, specifically investigating the phenomenon of diffraction, which is important today not only because it's a physical behavior of light, but also because it's a way to see molecules at the molecular level. Crystalline molecules act like diffraction gratings and can diffract X-rays in ways that allow us to determine bond lengths and angles, which is really useful. But in addition to that, molecules and atoms and other types of matter have wave-like properties, and so understanding something about the way waves work gives us insight into quantum mechanics. In the rest of the experiment, we'll see the physical consequences of quantum behavior. Specifically, we'll see that excited atoms, atoms that have been given energy, specifically through either a flame or high voltage applied across the atoms, tend to release the energy in discrete chunks. So rather than emitting a rainbow of colors, we only see very specific wavelengths of light emitted by excited atoms. We'll see that in action both in electric discharge tubes and in flame tests. In the first part of the experiment, we'll investigate the diffraction of laser light. And diffraction is a really interesting phenomenon that's particular to waves. So to show you what diffraction looks like, imagine we take a laser pointer and we send that laser light through a grating that has very, very small slits spaced at very, very tiny distances. If the distances are small enough, then what we see when we place a piece of paper or some other detector at a distance from the grating is that the one laser beam has spread out into multiple spots, and there are more than four. I've drawn four here, but they continue spreading out infinitely, but get fainter and fainter as we move outward from the center. This device called a grating is really at the microscopic level just very, very tiny slits that are separated by a particular distance. And on the microscopic level, what diffraction looks like is the spreading of a wave that's very large in relation to the slit size, so that at each slit, we get a new point source, and waves spread out from each slit and start overlapping with each other. So to the left of the slit, on the side of the laser beam, the individual beam, we see a very broad wave. But each slit becomes a new source for a new wave on the other side, and these waves interfere with each other, and that leads to the pattern of spots that you see on the wall beyond. Where the waves reinforce one another, where a peak meets a peak of the wave, we have constructive interference, and there we see a spot since the waves are reinforcing one another. And where the waves cancel, we don't see anything, and we call this destructive interference because the negative part of one wave is overlapping with the positive part of another wave so that the net sum is zero and we don't see any light at all. There's actually a mathematical relation that allows us to relate the angle of diffraction, the angle that a spot makes with the grating, to the microscopic distance between the slits. This is really useful. It's why, for example, we can use diffraction of X-rays to measure atomic distances. X-rays have just the right wavelength and energy to allow us to measure interatomic distances in crystals. If we call the distance between slits d and the wavelength of the wave lambda, and as a brief aside, this is the wavelength here because each line of the wave indicates a peak. So the peak-to-peak distance is also the wavelength of the wave. You're not seeing troughs here, but you can imagine the troughs of each wave as halfway between the peaks. And let's call the angle between the line connecting the spot and the grating and the normal to the grating theta. So the larger theta is, the farther away that spot is from the central spot. With these variables set down, we can say that diffracted light obeys the following relation. N times lambda, where n is just an integer, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, etc., is equal to d times the sine of theta. And I won't go into detail as to why this relation works, except to say that for waves to overlap constructively, for waves to interfere and reinforce one another, they need to be both at a peak when they reach the detector. And the only way for that to happen is if a wave that's adjacent to another wave travels an integral number of wavelengths from the starting point. That's the basis of this relation, essentially. But notice what it allows us to do. If we know lambda, the wavelength of the light, which we will because we'll be using a laser that has a standard wavelength, and we know the angle, which we can measure using a little bit of trigonometry and measurements of the distance between spots and the distance between the grating and the wall, then we can determine D, the microscopic distance between slits, which is far, far too small to actually measure empirically. That's the ultimate purpose of the first part of the experiment, to determine this microscopic distance D in a diffraction grating. But it's worth keeping in mind that this exact same process is what crystallographers use to determine interatomic distances in crystals during X-ray diffraction experiments. In the second part of the experiment, we'll use spectroscopes and electric discharge lamps to look at the atomic emission spectra of a variety of atoms. We'll go into the hydrogen atom in detail, but I want to talk in general about the instrumentation and the theory first. The instrument we'll use to do this is called a spectroscope, and a general schematic of a spectroscope is shown for you here. On the right-hand side, it has a tiny slit to let light through, and on the back of it, on the inside, it has a scale that's a wavelength in nanometers. So you look through a hole at the bottom, and what you see when you look inside that hole is a scale in nanometers running from about 400 to about 800. In other words, the range of visible wavelengths from red to violet. Light enters through that slit, and at the back of the spectroscope, we have a diffraction grating and a mirror so that the light spreads out at that point into its different wavelengths. Notice the relation above. Diffraction is wavelength dependent. The angle theta depends on the wavelength lambda. So if the wavelength changes, the angle changes. And that's the basis of the ability of the spectroscope to spread out light on the basis of wavelength. Different wavelengths bounce off the grating, essentially, at different angles. The light gets reflected back onto the scale inside the spectroscope. So if you look at the scale, you can see the wavelengths that composed the original input light. So for example, the scale might run from 750 to 400 with red and 750 on the left and violet 400 on the right. We might see a red line right around here, around 650, and we might see a blue line right about here. So if the input light contained both red and blue wavelengths, and that's it, we would see these two lines at the back of the spectroscope. Somewhat surprisingly, if you think about the typical model of the atom, atoms emit only very specific wavelengths of light when they're excited and they're relaxing back to the ground state. These correspond to differences in energy between their electronic quantum energy levels. So for example, for a hypothetical atom, I've drawn an orbital energy diagram where the horizontal lines show us the energies that electrons can take on, and the vertical axis is energy. So as we move up, we get to higher and higher energies. When we excite an atom, using, for example, an electric discharge, it can relax back down to a lower energy level by emitting a photon of light. The energy of that photon of light is equal to h times its frequency nu. And if we substitute n for the frequency nu, the speed of light divided by the wavelength, we get that the energy difference is equal to h, Planck's constant, times the speed of light divided by the wavelength. So the discreteness of the energies then guarantees that we only have particular values of delta E, which translates physically into specific wavelengths that we observe. What this also means is that we can take those measured wavelengths and we can actually build an orbital energy diagram from the measured wavelengths, provided we appreciate that each wavelength really corresponds to an energy difference between atomic orbital levels. It's very difficult to calculate atomic energy levels for atoms that are heavier than hydrogen, so this empirical process of measuring wavelengths is very valuable for constructing atomic energy diagrams. And just briefly as an aside, the NIST webbook of atomic spectral properties is based on this idea. It constructs atomic orbital energies from measurements of the wavelengths of light emitted by excited atoms. Because it has only one proton and one electron, the hydrogen atom is a little bit easier to study theoretically than heavier atoms. And in fact, it's possible to calculate theoretically the energy levels of the hydrogen atom. If you do that and you lay those levels down on an orbital energy diagram, you get something that looks like this. The lowest level, which corresponds to a principal quantum number or n value of 1, is at the bottom. And then you move up to n equals 2, and then you move up a little less to n equals 3, up a little less to n equals 4, etc., etc., etc. And all the energies are negative. So when E equals 0, the proton and electron are infinitely separated, and the hydrogen atom has essentially come apart into positive proton, negative electron. So the lower energies correspond to bound states, where the proton and electron are somehow bound to each other. Transitions between these levels can be observed as the wavelengths emitted by an excited hydrogen atom. For example, a transition from the N equals 2 level down to the N equals 1 level is in the ultraviolet region of the spectrum. And you'll notice that transitions down to the N equals 1 level that come from higher levels, so 3 to 1, 4 to 1, 5 to 1, are all higher energy than the N equals 2 to N equals 1 transition. So all of these are ultraviolet light and beyond. So we won't be able to observe those using, for example, a spectroscope, which can measure visible light only. Transitions to the N equals 2 level, on the other hand, you should notice are a little bit smaller in energy. So the 3 to 2 transition is much smaller in energy than the 2 to 1 transition, and the 4 to 2 is much smaller, for example, than the 3 to 1. Because these energies are smaller than the energies to the N equals 1 level, these fall in the visible region of the spectrum, and we can observe these using a spectroscope. This series of transitions from N equals 3, 4, 5, and 6 down to the N equals 2 level are called the Balmer series, and it's the easiest to study because those transitions do lead to the production of visible light. In the laboratory, what we'll do is use the spectroscope and an atomic discharge lamp containing hydrogen to measure the wavelengths emitted by excited hydrogen atoms that fall in the visible range. From this, we can get delta E values using the idea that the energy of a photon is equal to Planck's constant times its frequency, or Planck's constant times the speed of light divided by its wavelength. And then our goal is to figure out which delta E corresponds to which transition. So they all end at the N equals 2 level, but the question becomes, what's the initial level associated with the transitions? And think about it intuitively here. It's not as complicated as it sounds. Higher energy transitions are going to be associated with higher principal quantum numbers for the starting state. So the 4 to 2 transition is higher than the 3 to 2 transition, for example, and the 5 to 2 transition is going to be higher in energy than the 4 to 2 transition. Once we've figured out the initial quantum numbers for all these transitions, we're going to plot the change in energy for the transition versus 1 over the initial principal quantum number squared. And this might look a little bit cryptic, but the neat thing about this plot that you'll notice is that it produces a line. A line has the form y equals mx plus b, where m is the slope and b is the y-intercept. And here, because of the way we've assigned the axes, y is delta e and x is 1 over ni squared. So another way to think about this is that delta e is equal to m divided by n squared plus b. What I want you to think about before going into the laboratory is, what does m represent? What are the units of m, and what do you think it represents in terms of physically meaningful quantities for the hydrogen atom? And secondly, I want you to think about what b represents. So b is equal to delta e when the x value is equal to 0. And x being equal to 0 for an x-axis of 1 over n initial squared implies that n initial is infinite. What's the situation when n initial is infinite? And how does that translate into something that's physically meaningful? This will clue you in to the meaning of the y-intercept of this graph. In the final part of the experiment, we'll do flame tests on a variety of metal ions. And by now, we have all the theoretical background to understand how a flame test works. In a flame, thermal energy excites atoms. So there's a huge amount of thermal energy inside a flame. And so electrons in atoms get excited to higher energy levels, and they emit light, and we see that as the color of the flame. Because the levels are spaced differently in different types of atoms, each atom exhibits particular colors, particular wavelengths of light that the excited atoms emit as they transition between energy levels. So in the last part of the experiment, we'll make qualitative observations of the colors of different metal ions. Although it is possible in theory to measure the light given off by a flame using a spectroscope, for example, to determine the wavelengths emitted, it's a little bit difficult operationally to hold a metal solution in a flame and measure its wavelengths emitted at the same time. So we'll only deal with qualitative observations in this part of the experiment.